Good afternoon. I think so this is last session, and Julia is on the other side, so I can understand. So see, this talk is about the project which I did a while ago, and is more of a demonstration of how system evolves in Haskell, and particularly I was fond of Apache Sparks, and I wanted to recreate some of its sophistication into the way Haskell works with Haskell type system. So the reason I started doing this was for, although it was my coursework, also I wanted to use part of it in my day-to-day problem. Particularly, we applied this problem to in a geometry application, wherein you have a very large ship and you wanted to find out how many compartments are kind of intersecting with each other, because the model that we got from our CAD modeler wasn't very good, and then we always wanted to have a clean model, and doing that on a small model of a ship was fine. But when it came to like models with about 65 compartments, 18,000 plates, I mean these are called plates, and so in all about total 45,000 elements were there, and then suddenly it was out of the bound. Spark was kind of out of option because the ecosystem was such that we couldn't use Java or JVM runtime, so we wanted to have some solution in which we could do things quickly and not too sophisticatedly, but could solve our problem. So this was also useful there, and that is the basic background. And so this is inspired from Apache Spark, but it is loosely based on Spark. Like Apache Spark, it is distributed. It does in-memory computation, but we also had places where we wanted to store a lot of files on disk, which typically happens with many CAD models. I don't know how many of you have worked on CAD models, because my background is from computer aided design and most of geometry, and not really from other thing. So the problems that we get are little different, because we have to get into space partitioning and those kind of things. So we had lot of files on the disk, and then although it is in memory computation, we also ended up doing some computation to read files from the disk. So you will find the repository there, and the way I want to structure this is like basically I want to build some understanding of Spark, not that we don't know Spark, just to understand why the systems behave in a certain way. Then we will look at some of the implementations in Haskell that we have. So in fact there is already an implementation which fits into Spark, so why should I use this? But this is, as I said, this is a side project, so that question is kind of I mean I don't want to ask myself. Then I wanted to demonstrate the system was built, and then I basically how it evolved into kind of a more elaborate system. And then accidentally I kind of discovered and then could use the monadic parallelization pattern, and then that is how the implementation stands, although it's not complete yet. But that is what I wanted to achieve, like describe the elements of Spark subsystem, describe the way Haskell is viewed around it to achieve that, and then how can we take that model as a base model, and then how can we build on top of it to create something elaborate. So that's the basic agenda. Please feel free to stop me at any point of time, because I guess this would be a longish session, and then I do want to jump into code from time to time. And also, in a way, I want to expose myself, because then I would like to invite a lot of questions as to how things could be done, how it could have been better. So please make it like a discussion. I would kind of welcome it. My target audience is kind of beginner to intermediate. It's like someone who knows about Haskell and somebody who had worked for some time with Haskell. And also would like to understand the Haskell ecosystem around the distributed or cloud Haskell, so that it's possible to build application on top of it. And it's not the walk in the park kind of thing, like I write programs in otherwise pure code, you know. I mean, I enjoy writing pure code, and suddenly when it gets to distributed Haskell, it's not true. Suddenly I encounter many difficulties, and then I have to get around them. And even some of the things that are being done looks like hackish things, but that is how they are. Probably recently I've been to the Haskell exchange, and there has also the same similar questions were asked, like how can we support polymorphic type in a better way, or more than rank one types in a better way, and probably we'll get better answers. So understanding Apache Spark, the reason why I like Apache Spark is actually very simple, because anyone who has tried to build a distributed system of any kind, he knows that creating such a system is extremely hard. It's very difficult to get it right first time, and it is very difficult to, even if you try to write specifications in a protocolish way, if you will, even then it's very difficult. And if you want to write something like consensus, then it's extremely difficult to write. So why do I like Spark? Because it allows me to specify my problem without understanding the complexities of distributed system at a very low level. So it kind of hides a lot of things from me, and still it allows me to specify jobs in a linear way, and then it allows me to do calculations. So Spark has built in a lot of sophistications, like recovery and fault tolerant. If you start it on a Mesos worker, and then if you shut it down, if it's not available for some reason, then it kind of recreates the whole hierarchy again. And those kinds of things makes it a perfect candidate also to replicate model of. So from that perspective, I'm not trying to create get into basics of RDD, only at a very general level, wherein we would like to understand what's going on. Okay. So if you look at Spark program, it's actually presents you with a very simple DSL. Can you read it? Or okay, right? No, the code is not doing much, so it should be okay. So basically, the model is very simple. You create an RDD from the existing data, and you keep on building top of it, and you keep on building in terms of map and reduce, join, sample, union, those kinds of jobs. So it's like it creates a DAG or a cyclic graph, in which you have something on the root, and then you keep on, at every stage you add something on top of it, and then that is how you specify your job. So the advantage of such a system is that it's easy. I mean, even for a layman, it's very easy to understand what's going on here. So you can sense that it's trying to read some lines from some data source, then finding errors. So filtering only on the errors. And then again zooming on to only certain kinds of errors, and that is where you are interested. Another thing to remember here is that the whole pipeline is specified, but it's not executed immediately. So when you say that unless and until you do some kind of call cache or by some other means force the calculation, it's not going to evaluate itself. Something that Haskell can do very well, so that's good. But because of these kind of pipelines, it's very easy to create these kinds of jobs. So before getting into actual implementations, let's try to understand more about data and its dependencies. So we have few pipelines, like for example map and filter, wherein the pipe that the dependency is direct. So when I say dependency is direct, it means that this is my data, and then as you can see that it is partitioned into different partitions, but each partition maps to a corresponding partitions when you apply a map or a filter. I mean, I don't have to get out of the my base partition, and then I can directly it's a one-to-one correspondence between child and parent. Sorry about that. So this is called direct dependency. Now it doesn't really matter where the partitions are. So partitions can be present on the same node or the same machine, or they can be present on a different machine. Although Spark will try to optimize the co-location of these partitions, it will not guarantee co-location of these partitions. But nevertheless, there is a direct dependency. With co-located dependency, things become something like this. So you might have partitions, but these partitions are replicated across different nodes. So this is one node, this is another node, and both contain similar partitions. So if you want to achieve something, you have to contact both these nodes and partitions. So your dependency is not only on the parent partition, but on partitions which are located across. So this is called as co-located dependency. And then when we try to do something like group by or reduce, then since we have to operate on all the keys, and then the keys might not be partitioned exactly on one node, so it results in a what is called as shuffle dependency, because then you have to go back and forth between all the nodes in the worst case. So that is the void or shuffle dependency. So Spark kind of identifies the difference between direct dependency, co-located dependency, and shuffle dependency. So basically all this came from the original Spark paper. You must have read, of course. And what Spark tries to do is optimize the data transfer and moving of the partitions between two nodes, so that it can do the job efficiently. Not only that, it also maintains the lineage of all the partitions. So for example, so this again example is taken from the Spark paper, and this mentions about the page rank algorithm, and there are various stages in the algorithm, and those are maintained, but at the same time their dependencies is also maintained. The reason why dependency is maintained is because if for some reason some node becomes unavailable, for some reason a particular partition or its RDD is lost, then looking at the lineage, it's possible to recreate it. So that's the reason why this kind of lineage is also maintained in the Spark ecosystem. So some kind of failures are handled. I mean, if you have a very catastrophic kind of a failure, it will report error anyway. And then if you try to look at the overall picture, then you can see that the things are done in various stages. So this is the stage one in which a group by operation is done. This is a simple map, and then a union is done, and finally there is a join, which results in these three nodes, and together it represents the data. So now the main aim is to somehow replicate this kind of features using Haskell and using distributed Haskell. So now there are already existing systems, and this is one system which recently came out. You can actually go and look at this application. It is an interesting one because at the core it has inline Java, some component that they say that it's ready to come out of it, but I haven't seen it yet. It wraps itself in a jar file as a Spark job, so you can actually submit it using Spark submit. And the API that you write in Haskell closely mocks, in fact, almost same as the Spark syntax that you have seen few slides before. So definitely worth a look at, and I haven't run it frankly, but the blog that this link points to, it's amazing the way they have mentioned. In fact, these are the same guys who wrote distributed Haskell, so no wonder it came from them. And I also wonder why they didn't base it on distributed Haskell. They kind of pushed and wrapped it inside the Spark jar file. So inline Java is something very similar to inline C and other things, but this is a very good candidate to look at. In fact, they also have R binding to Haskell, so not only you can do Spark programming, but you can also do R programming in Haskell. This is another library which you will find on Hackage, and they are little different than distributed Haskell in terms of how they approach it. At the core level, the concepts are very similar, how you want to transfer the code from one node to another node. I had some help from one of the team members of this to do few things related to asynchronous process creation, but and they also have a paper coming up which would be published in next ICFP or this ICFP, not sure, but worth a look again. And so now we are coming to the implementation on which we are going to demonstrate our code. So this is distributed Haskell, also they call it cloud Haskell, and they specifically use static pointers and remote table, and we'll see what those are. And of course they can do monomorphic types, but it is also possible to handle rank one polymorphic types in there, and in doing that they use closures. So we'll see what these are and why they are required. But the development is not very active. I mean, for a long time they are on version 0.6, and the last version came up in February, and it's the GitHub repository is not very active, but I guess they are also doing a lot of things otherwise. In fact, initially they created this remote table approach, and that kind of inspired Haskell core guys to implement static pointers inside GHC. So if you are interested, you can go to like Haskell on cloud, and then you can find Simon Peyton-Jones' GHC web page, wherein he describes why and how of static pointers. So something very core to distributed Haskell, and this is where it is like, how can we send a data over the wire? How does it happen in Java, or how does it happen in Scala or Java or JVM based language? Like, so we know that the Scala objects are serializable, the case objects are directly serializable, and it's possible to serialize closure also. So we can take the closure object and its closure to another location and recreate it. How can I do it in Haskell? It's pure. I don't know how to do it, right? I can't even because runtime, all the type information is gone. It's very hard to imagine how one can go about it. So that is why the static pointer extension is added in GHC 7.8, and it's an interesting one. But because of it, it is possible to use, create a function, create a static pointer to it, and then take it another site, and then exactly call the same function. So we'll see about it. So to be able to use a static pointer in Haskell, you have to enable the static PTR extension, which you would put it on the top. But this is the basic usage of how you can use it. So if you have suppose a function called square, and it does its job to just square the number, integer, and then you can actually use the static keyword. And if you use the static keyword and pass the function to it, then you will get a static pointer. And then you can actually get the information about that pointer, and it will give you module name, the function name, and a lot of things about it. So the whole lineage or the provenance of that function is stored into it. At the same time, you actually can dereference that pointer and apply an argument to it and get the result back. So it's possible to write a function, pure function or impure, it doesn't matter. You can actually go ahead and create a static pointer, dereference it, and call it back. So far so good. I mean, this is good, but how I can use it? How I can use it to take my function, which is in created here, maybe in the same environment, and then take it to some other location, transfer it over the wire, and recreate that environment over there. So static pointer itself will not do that work. So it's not sufficient. So I haven't left the. I just wanted to provide the function declaration. So if you look at the static pointer, then it provides information about package, the module in which it is there, the name, and some other information. But most important thing that it gives is like a key. And this key provides a way to serialize this function or data to another location and recreate it. The static key is nothing but a fingerprint, which is again defined in the core GHC. And this fingerprint is some kind of a hash. and that hash, so every function is so if you whenever you create a when you say static and give some function, then it will be hashed, and that hash will be stored into a table, which that table will be stored in the same module, and that table will contain this hash. So now I have a way to take the fingerprint. Now this fingerprint is just a set of hash, so now I can actually pass it on the wire, and now I can recreate it back. So if I have a static key, I kind of save it, go to another place in which similar things are there, and then see if that static key key is there or not. Then I can have this function. The in the current version it is defined in unsafe way, but I don't know, I haven't looked in yet, but in 8.0 they said that it might be safe version there. But the implementation that I have, it uses the unsafe version. So now what I can do is, if I have two connected nodes, then I can take the static key, send it on the wire, and then look up whether that static key is there, and then maybe I will get that function or whatever back. And then again, using the dereference, I can have that function back. I apply arguments, so I can do and resume my calculations over there. So far so good. Yes. Both node they have to have the same basic substrate. It is possible to build on top of it and then transfer the whole thing to another node. That is possible.
Okay.
Pardon?
How can you do that?
So that is what we are going to look at. But the substrate has to be same. You cannot change, but you can change the context, and that is what is called as closure. So this itself will take you, and then you will be able to decipher the or get the function back. But then it's not sufficient, right? You not only you have to decipher the function, you also have to take the data from one place, and you have to apply in the same way to the function, the way you want to apply it here. That's what is called closure, because eventually in Scala or in Java also you do the same thing, right? When you serialize it, you actually not only serialize the object but also serialize the closure around it. So now I can define something like this. So if I have a so now this is a static, which is actually one of the type in distributed Haskell, which actually is a wrapper over the static extension that Haskell has, and also the remote table concept that distributed Haskell has. We'll see what that remote table is, but it's enough to understand that the static of a function. Okay, suppose we have a first function, and then you have some data, and that also data you have converted to some static pointer. Then you can actually compose it and get the static back. Now this gives you a way to create to compose few things. So now if suppose you have two functions, and if you create two statics, suppose you have a function B to C and then A to B, just like function composition in pure Haskell, you can do it you can compose static functions and create a resultant function and now send it over to another side. But at the same time, you should understand that this itself is again not sufficient, but because we are again talking about function and recreating at other side, not how we are transferring it, right? So that is also we need to understand, and that is what the closure does. So what we do is, in distributed Haskell, is that we build a closure around the static. And the basic definition is very simple. You have a static in which you get some kind of binary representation of the data, and then you get the data type out. So this is a static function which you want to apply, and this is the data which you want to decode. This is the encoded data. Suppose you have a lot of data which you encoded into some kind of binary string, and now you create a closure using static, which is byte string to some type A, and then build a closure around it. So given such a function, encoded data which you have to decode, you get a closure. And this closure is again So this closure you can again compose in the same way you could compose static. Do let me know if you have anything. Okay. Yes. So basically, a static is a fingerprint. It's a hash, and that hash points to some table inside the runtime system that you have running. Now, on top of it, you add the byte string, which is a binary string, which is an encoded string from some data. You might have a tree, or you might have a lot of integers, anything. And then the whole thing, you put it together so that you can actually pass it as an object and recreate them, and then apply the function and then run it over there. That's the idea. So this is okay? Yeah. Yes. No, this is the decoder, right? So when this byte string is taken to the other side or on a different machine, and when this static is deciphered, then you can apply this byte string to this function and get this A back. Since this static is represented as a fingerprint, this is nothing but a byte string. So what you are transferring is a byte string and byte string. And then you are taking it to another side, deciphering it, converting it to a function pointer, applying it, and then you will get type A back. No. Since we have to transfer the fingerprint, and that fingerprint has to be present on another side. So as I said, the substrate has to be common. It's not possible to create code base. Yeah.
It's not like a
disappeared. No. In fact, it's one of the pain points, right? But that's how it is. Sometimes, like, simple things are easy, but because it has all static types, and then it has to remove all the types at the runtime, you cannot do certain things very easily. So you have to have an elaborate mechanism to do this. Okay. But this also has some limitations. We are going to see it. So this has some limitation. In Haskell, we always deal with type classes, right? The square function that we have seen, it was operating on integers. What if we have a function which takes the type class constraint? So I have a number which I want to square. Now if I take it to the other side, this type class information is going to get lost. And this is also because of the way Haskell is implemented. What happens is that this type class is converted to a type dictionary, and this dictionary is passed to the function. Since we are not converting that dictionary into any encoded format, that information is simply lost. So if we do transfer this function will not be, will not work on the other side. Because there is no way it will understand that this function has a constraint of numerical type. So it still has a problem, right? And what we want to do is, we want to serialize data, and then the way to serialize data is declare an instance of binary type plus. And binary type plus allows me to serialize a type of data A to a byte string and get it back. So I don't want to write binary conversion for every type. I would just use binary class type. So it means that even if I have a static type, I have closure, I will not be able to simply take my type and put it on other side and get it back. I still have to do few things. So taking monomorphic type to other location is easy. Taking integer there will be easy. Taking a byte string would be easy. But taking a type class constraint will require some more efforts. And so that is where we have to, and that is where even in the distributed Haskell, this trick is applied, which is called a dictionary trick. And actually, surprisingly, same dictionary trick, similar kind of dictionary is created by Haskell runtime when you create an instance of a type class and is passed to the function. So now, suppose I want to encode the dictionary or the type class, right? Suppose my function is taking argument which are ordered. So basically what I do is I create a GADT, algebraic data type, in which I force the type A to be ordered. But nowhere, it's a phantom type, nowhere that data is present there. But since I told that this has to be an instance of order type, Haskell will put that dictionary and enclose it around. So when I recreate the serialized data of order dictionary, it will give me, it will force the order type class on that. So I have to hide that order and then again disclose it on the other side. So if you take the same example in which you have a square which works on a numerical side, so what you would do is you would create a numerical dictionary where the constructor will force type A to be numerical. Most of the time you would like to have typeable and binary, and that is already provided. So those types are already provided. If you want to support your own type classes, then you have to do something like this. Sometimes you have to do it. I mean, for example, in reduce step, if I want to achieve reduce step, then my keys has to be ordered. So then I have to tell the runtime that and encode order dictionary into it. So this is kind of a pain, but I mean, I don't know, but looks like a sophisticated pain, right? But this is how it is, and still has a problem. You still cannot take a polymorphic type to the other side. So for that, there is a concept of a remote table. So let us, I have example of it. You can read it, I suppose. I can increase the size. So this guy, distributed Haskell, gives me a template macro in which I can register my polymorphic function, and then it creates a string dictionary of types. So there is a library called rank1 dynamic. So these are rank1 types. So so if you have a function, say f from a to b, then it will convert it into any to any one, and it will, since it has no other constraint, as long as you have two different types, it should be all right. If you have a constraint of a type class, then you would have already encoded that into some kind of a type dictionary, and then the rank one dynamic library is able to resolve that as well. So there are two ways of getting your functions on the other side. So one, for monomorphic types, use static extensions, and for polymorphic types, use remote table. And those remote tables, now you have to ensure that the same remote tables exist on all the nodes. Fortunately, when you create nodes, and if you have a, if you start with a transport model in which you present the remote table, then it is replicated on all other nodes as well. So once you have it on one node, it's possible to have it on other nodes. So so that was about the main, the core part of it, like how to take your code to other side. So now we can talk about how we can manage things on multiple machines. Now once we have taken care of transferring from one side to another side, what we can do is, there is a logical compartmentization called node. So you can have multiple nodes on the same machine. It's a bit similar to Akka. So you can have separate actor systems. You can either in the same process, or you can have it as a different processes on the same machine, and it's called node. So you can have nodes as a logical partitions between two subsystems, and then what happens is that node is a container, so also kind of a owner of all the things that are inside. So if you terminate a particular node, all the things that are there will also terminate. So the unit of execution in distributed Haskell is process. So a node can contain multiple process, and when they communicate, they will communicate using the binary signatures or binary serialization over the wire. So you can either send a request and receive it, which is a typed message, or you can establish a channel, and that channel is more secure and faster, because the way it is implemented is like it uses the transactional memory to transfer message from one node, one process to another process. If you just send a message and just specify the address, suppose I want to send a message from process 2 to process 3, and I just send it, then it has to do a lookup, it has to resolve which process it want to send to, and then finally it will reach the process. Fortunately, there is a faster method called channel. You can establish a channel between two processes, and then that will speed up the transfer of data between two processes. So now we have nodes, which are logical containers, and we have processes which live in nodes, and as I said, they can talk to each other using these basic communication channels. STM is heart of it, at the heart of it, but it is deeply seated, so that you don't have to look at its implementation very often. So if you are in the same node, then you don't have to have a closure. you just start a process. So inside the same node, you just spawn a process, and that's it. Only when you have to create a process on another node, you have to do it specifically with the closure. So indeed, there are two versions of creating process. So you can spawn local, in which you will create a process on the same machine, same node, and spawn, which is like remote version of it. And of course, for spawn, you need a closure, right? So Akka has a receive method to receive a lot of messages, and then it creates a partial function, and you can concatenate two partial functions, and that's it. This process work in a little different way. Actually, it's more of a general version of Bcom in Akka. So more of a finite state machine, as that's the way you can look at it. And Akka also has it, but it's a I don't know whether it's an add-in or plugin, I don't know. But it's like the moment you receive it, you always get a chance to transform its state into another state. And that's a good way of designing it, because you can look at your process as a finite state machine. And once you have a process, you can also link to the process to monitor it. And whenever the process is killed, it's not reachable, or you want to cancel after some time, it's possible to do it through linking. So this was like, now we have all the machinery to build our own implementation. So we can go about it now. So what I created is like a special kind of a process which with a fixed life cycle, and it does only serves few purpose. Like it is created, it is live now, it stores something, and it expects some fetch. Somebody will take that data, and once someone takes that data, it will terminate itself. The whole purpose is to live temporarily on some kind of node. And then you can create multiple such partitions, and you can communicate with those processes. So this is again a phantom type. So this type doesn't appear in the constructor at all, but it allows me to fetch that data from these processes. And this is a building mechanism which is used while creating a system wherein we have a lot of partitions and transferring the data from one partition to another partition. So blocks is like a set of partitions. So now you can actually create a partition which create a special block which can talk to many blocks at the same time. And this actually gives a good way of creating union. I mean, for the union, there is no cost, right? I just have to create a map to different partitions of the same type. And the type system allows me to only map blocks which are of the same type. And then this is how the data will be transferred. So each partition is actually nothing but a block. And once you transfer the data, this will get terminated and it will become another block. So when I transfer the closure is applied and it gets resulted into another block. These are some sundry things to do management. So you have to have a master node on which you will get the result. And all the slave nodes are used to create partitions, transfer the data, and do a processing. You will need a remote table so that you know that you are running the same things at all the nodes. And the strategy is not used right now. But strategy I found little ineffective the way I implemented it, but the initial intention was to create different strategies for executions. The definition of RDT itself now becomes very simple. So as long as you have a data that can be serialized, you can create an RDT. And the main function that type class needs is a flow which tells how that data can move to some block B. Now we can use this definition to create a composable stack of RDTs. And so when the whole system is run, this is a very toy program which does a small job. So you create, tell how many partitions you want. If you don't specify any partitions, all the nodes are used for partitions. But if you give number of partitions, then only those number of nodes used to store the partitions. And if you remember how the Spark DSL looked like, this looks like something similar, although you have to provide extra dictionary types now so that it knows how to serialize it on the other side. So you seed the data, you map it, you provide the reduce step, and finally only when you collect it, only then all the transformations will be done. So again, you need this dictionary trick to provide the qualified type information to this RDT. Any questions? So basically, actually, I can just run the test. That would be better, I guess. The tests are very small, but they exemplify the system really well. So this shows the whole example of how you can create multiple nodes and create the data. So I'm generating, specifying a job with random 100 numbers and then doing reductions to on the sum partitions. And it works well. So basically, when I ran the intersections that initially I talked about, I got about 5 to 6 times speed up, which was kind of good for me. So coming back to the implementation now flows with the type class definition. So you have a seed in which you tell how many partitions you need, which actually comes from the context. Then you need a closure of the data that you want to push, and you need a dictionary of what you want to push. Similarly, you can also create a map. Map looks little different because now you have to specify, you have to have three types. Okay, so the base is an RDD which gives you B, and you want to produce C. So you have to closure of B to C. So when you have a base, you apply the closure, you will get the type C. So what you are providing is, you are providing the way to compose things together. Now, so this block will be transferred to another location, and that's the way to do the mapping operation on the other side. Implementation itself is very simple. So you get all the blocks which represents the data for the base system, and you just map over all these blocks to send the closure over to some nodes, and you spawn a process over there, and you just wait for all those processes. So all those processes which are created are the ones you are interested in. So the all operations are now scheduled. They will run on the other system, and now you just have to wait for those to complete. In the meanwhile, if any of those would fail, then you, since the master node would link to those processes, you will get a notification. Recovery is not there. So I just get a notification and then I stop. That's it. Sometimes it hangs too, but most of the times it goes through cleanly. At least on Linux and Mac, it works well. Windows, I had a lot of issues, but I wasn't able to solve it. Reduction was a problem because I have to get the ordered dictionary in. I also have to have serializable dictionary in, and there is no simpler way of doing it rather than having all of them together here. And then this is a partitioning function. In Spark, the partitioning function is kind of automatic. Even if you don't specify one, it will use one depending on the type that you are dealing with. But here, we have to do that. Probably we can decipher for some simpler types, but I don't think it's possible. So better to specify one here. And reduction happens typically in two steps. So it doesn't happen in one step. So if there was a paper by Ralph Lamel from Google, and then he had actually put forward a lot of things to how reduced step can happen using pure functional languages. So typically he advised for two-step processes. One in which you create partitions and then you segregate the data in multiple parts. In the second step, now using all those partitions on all those nodes, you take the data and do the reduction step. So the first step is to partition. Second step is to do actual reduction. So shuffling happens in two places. So that way, the transfer between, I mean, the processing is reduced because partitioning has already happened, and I exactly know which partition to go to receive the data. So this is the implementation. So I roll over all the slaves and spawn the first stage. Again, you can see the step one closure is passed, and I wait for all those process IDs for the second stage. And stage two is shuffling, in which this is where the combiner function, in which I have to combine two values together, is passed. Again, it is scheduled on those machines. So the execution kind of is applies with a simple balancer, like it's a round robin kind of thing. If you schedule one task on one node, next task will be scheduled on next node, and it is rolled over. The direct dependencies are always localized. I think it's very naive to do that, but it gives a good result, at least for the purpose that I was running the job. And so execution strategy was actually simple, and it actually was trying to equally distribute the nodes, whatever that was present. And important thing was that the concept of a block, and that I found really good, although other things could improve, like. The process could represent a storage block. And not only that, I can modify my block process not only to store data in memory. It doesn't matter if I store the data on the disk also, or it doesn't matter if I store data on HDFS. I can retrieve it back depending on the scheduler, or if I want to implement some LRU strategy. So that was good. But there were a lot of limitations. So, I mean, tests were, I mean, we still have to improve a lot of things. But controlling life of a process was a problem, because sometimes the process being an IO process, it would kill. Although I would get a notification, it was difficult to kind of recover from that. And this has been solved. So I'm told by those guys are that the on the local node serialization doesn't happen. The data is directly connected to another process, even if you spawn it with a closure. So it has that kind of optimization built in. But now I wanted to go further. So that is where this is still under development, but it is very interesting to look at the implementation, because I want to, now I have a specification. And but if you see the implementation, the moment I specify map job, all my processing is defined immediately. I mean, it defines how things can be run. I don't have any control on top of it. So the main thing I wanted to do is to separate the plan and the execution. So that is where now we could use a continuation monad. So using a continuation monad, at every step, what I can do is at every step, whenever I do a plan, so suppose I created a seed data, I create a map data, immediately I convert that step into some kind of a step which I can translate it to a scheduler, so that I can schedule the jobs asynchronously. And that is where this library was helpful. So this library was created by Simon Marlowe, and there is also a beautiful paper referring to it. What it does, it creates a par monad, and par monad is nothing but a continuation monad in which two threads talk to each other through IO reps, through shared memory. So there are two states, like empty state and full state. So either the IO ref is empty or it is full. Once it is full, the dependency will kick in using the scheduler, and then that step can be run. So it's very interesting to look at it, because the monad par library makes the calculation kind of deterministic. Although because of IO monad, even if it has lot of determinism, you cannot really say that it is fully deterministic. But IO monad was the reference point to again convert the execution that I had to a asynchronous execution on multiple nodes. So suppose some node is taking longer to run some process, I should be able to steal the work which is given to that node and put it on the another node. So this is a Fibonacci serialization. So just to get an idea, so this I and J in this continuation monad is nothing but a IO ref, and whenever you evaluate the values of this function, you will put it inside it, and then you will be able to get those values and use it somewhere. The same way I wanted to create a semantics for distributing work on the cloud. So rules are simple. So always have some unevaluated computation and pass it to monad. And then we need to ensure that the result of this computation is not required immediately, and that result can be shared so that other components of the program can use it. And this looks like a future, right? Because future does the same thing. You have some unevaluated component which you want sometime in future. So then now I have a plan. I can fork. I create a fork, and then this is a child plan, child process. This is the parent, and that itself will create a plan. I'm done with the task, and then I want to create a new task, and then I want to put the result back into the IRF. And the IRF, how can we create a IRF which is valid on the network, right? So before going into it, now I can also simplify my RDD definition by using algebraic type. So seed becomes data RDD. So as long as I have something serializable, actually I can create an RDD and specify all different RDDs in the same definition. So this looks like very similar to RDD in Scala, because it also has finite number of methods like sample, join, union, etc. So now I can take this RDD, put it inside a continuation monad, and create a step, a plan. So I can have a function which takes the RDD and creates the plan out of it. Once I have the plan, then I can use the scheduler to create execution mechanism to run on different machines. So now not only I have a separation between execution and scheduler, but I also have a freedom to choose my own scheduler. So I can choose to use my old scheduler again. So what I have to do is, I basically, the IRF now becomes a network IRF. So I wait for, so IRF is not a IRF which is created on this machine, but IRF can be somewhere on the network, and then its semantics makes it look like a IRF. So I can send a message. If it is not there, it will give me an empty. If the value is filled in, it will tell me the process ID where the value is filled in. And then I can go and get those values in the function. So if I have a procedure which takes a value and creates a process, I can translate it into a networked IRF kind of a thing and create a closure around it. Okay. So from a simple process which has a closure to IRF based process. So basically transforming this function into this function would give me a freedom to spawn a function anywhere on the node and get the data from anywhere on the network. So now I can actually cycle into all my nodes and have a control node wherein I can keep on scheduling these processes. And this should give me freedom. Should, because it's not yet done. Only the first step is done. So I cannot really tell how useful it is. So basically NIR becomes a networked IRF because it has the same semantics of IRF, and then but it resides on network. And however, it will point to the process in where the data is processed. So basically I don't want to copy it immediately. And it can have reference to reference. That I haven't that crossed my mind, but I haven't thought about it yet. I mean, that has to be taken care either by having redundant copies, but I mean I don't have any answer to it right now. But at least in a good situation, this should theoretically work. So now the scheduler is actually very simple. I mean, I can have a scheduler which run task on the same node. Once the one task is run, it will schedule the next task and the next one. Or I can have a work stealing pattern which will schedule work on all the nodes, and if some node is heavily loaded, then it will take out some load and put it on the another. And that implementation, I have actually taken it directly from the monadpar library. I wanted to use it directly as it was, but because of NIR, it's not possible. So that work is kind of still going. Finally, so these are the references where you can go ahead and look at. Yeah, so that was it. Yes, yes. Yeah, I have thought about it using template Haskell, but I haven't given much thought whether it would work or not. I'm not sure. Frankly, I'm not sure. Haskell is not doing that, right? Haskell is solving the n plus 1 problem in a deterministic way. Yes.
And maybe, I don't know, maybe if we had a virtual machine.
I don't know. I don't know, frankly. But when last week I was at Haskell Exchange, and Simon Pitton Jones explained how he can put some type rep information inside core as a trusted core.
I see.
And probably that could solve some of the issues. But I would still say that it would not solve all the issues because. We would have still the problems with the polymorphic types.
Indeed.
So that's not yet
yes.
solved. Yeah. Yes, yes. Actually, it's a reference to a process, right? So only thing that you are serializing is process ID. Yes. There is no closure present and you will get an error pack. It won't be spawned. In fact, you will get it immediately. Yeah. So you have to always bracket it so that you can handle that exception. The same code that you are running on one machine, the same code has to run on the other machine. The data and composition of functions. You could do that, yes. Maybe the way is like you send some template Haskell code and then reify at other end and probably you will get similar thing back. But I don't know anything about template Haskell. I haven't never used it. I don't know. Somehow I am afraid of using it. No, it runs in its own monad and creates its binding always. So, in fact, you can create overriding binding, means that actually it has a little different kind of execution engine going on there. Yes, yes. In fact, you know something, the static extension that you have, you cannot even run it in the interpreter. Yes, yes. Yeah. I guess when you do Spark submit, the jar file is co-located on every node and that is loaded. I think that's the same thing, right?
Yeah,
sending the template Haskell code and loading something using.
Yeah, the problem is that
The earlier company I used to work for, so we had a proprietary Haskellish language, and so we used to compile that into bytecode. And the whole bytecode used to be serialized. So it was very strict, but Haskellish language.
It's a strict Haskell.
So Mu might have heard in Standard Chartered Bank. It's written by the compiler written by Leonard Augustson, and it's used in Standard Chartered.
So it was a virtual machine as well, or you were running bytecode?
Always running the bytecode. And the good thing was that you could generate binding to other languages like F#, JavaScript, and then so once you have C++ APIs linked in, now you can access through F# or JavaScript. That was really good. No, it wasn't lazy at all.
Yeah, so. It'd be nice to try.
Yeah, it wasn't even recursive. It didn't support the recursion. Any other question? So do have a look at my repository, and then I invite you to participate, because this is my side project.
But yeah,
and
that was my next question. Do you use that in production, or is it
possible? I used it once to solve the intersection of objects.
Okay.
But that too scheduled few things on different machines. But not in production. Although someday I would like to. That's an interesting problem to solve, and I would like to use it. But being a side project, it always remains that way. Okay, thanks then.